Well, the guy that, number one, kills police should be strung up the next morning after he sees that fair trial, by the way.
For some, he was the ultimate law and order politician. Others called him an out-and-out racist. But Frank Rizzo preferred the title he once gave himself, the toughest cop in America. Today, after 3 years out of office, a somewhat lower-keyed Frank Rizzo, who concedes he's made his share of mistakes, announced that he's running for mayor of Philadelphia again.
Well, first of all,
we'll talk live with him tonight.
To be the underdog.
This is ABC News Nightline. Tonight, a profile. Frank Rizzo of Philadelphia. Reporting from Washington, Ted Koppel.
Good evening. Frank Rizzo is a Philadelphia policeman who was twice elected mayor of that city. The law, which prohibited Mr. Rizzo from running for a third consecutive term, may have saved him from some political embarrassment. The impression after 8 years of Frank Rizzo as mayor was that Philadelphia had had enough of his rambunctious, loud, sometimes ham-fisted approach to city government. But then there has never been a shortage of Philadelphians who believe that Frank Rizzo is unfit for office. In liberal, civil, libertarian circles, Mayor Rizzo is not simply disliked, he is despised. In fact, the Southeastern Pennsylvania chapter of Americans for Democratic Action put out a mocking compilation of Rizzo quotes entitled The Sayings of Chairman Frank. For example, Rizzo musing on capital punishment. Maybe we could have our own electric chair. I could throw the switch. Or on what to expect following his election. I'm going to make Attila the Hun look like a faggot. There's a book full of quotes like that. Frank Rizzo, to friends and enemies alike, is bigger and often more outrageous than life. And he's trying to make a political comeback. If he's successful, there could be a political message for the rest of the country. So we thought you should meet Frank Rizzo. Here's Bob Serkin with a profile.
In the history books, we all know it as the city of brotherly love, the cradle of liberty, the meeting place of our founding fathers. But this too is Philadelphia. The Mummers, pretzels and cheese steaks, the Eagles, Phillies, Flyers, and 76ers.
Anywhere in the world.
And from this Southside Italian neighborhood, Philadelphia has given us this impatient, impetuous, and fearless man, Frank Rizzo, called by some the Cisco Kid, called by himself America's toughest cop.
We have an element of criminals in our society that deserve no quarter, should be put in prison, and you believe me, I could care less how long they stay there.
For 24 years, Frank Rizzo rose through the ranks to Philadelphia's top cop with an insatiable appetite for action. Never missing a chance to assist his men, Rizzo would often rush to a crime scene, finding more trouble than he bargained for.
Rizzo won't be in Florida. He won't be down the seashore. Frank Rizzo will be where the action is.
Between 1955 and 57, Rizzo was twice charged with assault and battery. In one case in which he was arraigned, a judge dropped the charges. The judge was later fired for political patronage.
All Frank Rizzo has done all his life is protect people from criminals at great personal risk and discomfort.
As police commissioner, Rizzo's obsession with bringing a new brand of law and order to his city often created more hate than love, especially among blacks. In 1970, black radicals became targets of Rizzo's anti-crime campaign. He led his men, armed with rifles and tear gas, on a series of raids on Black Panther centers. He invited the press along to watch.
They're a little angry. They were humiliated. We took their pants off them to search them.
As complaints of brutality and racism grew, so did the city's crime rate by 19% between 1969 and 70. The police force was increased to 7,200 officers. Its budget hiked to $92 million. Frank Rizzo had become more than a police commissioner. He had become a powerful political force.
My opponent says it's going to be a close race in South Philadelphia.
In February 1971, Rizzo resigned his commissioner's job, becoming the first policeman to run for mayor of a major American city. His platform, law and order, without higher taxes. His campaign slogan, Rizzo means business.
10 years ago, if you said, I'm for law and order, you were automatically accused of being a racist. Didn't stop me, because I know I'm not a racist.
77% of Philadelphia's eligible voters, a record turnout, elected Frank Rizzo mayor. He carried more than half of the city's precincts. Rizzo's first term featured more controversy than productivity. He was accused of using taxpayers' money to refurbish his house, which he then allegedly undervalued. Upon taking office, Rizzo appointed his brother fire commissioner, even though he had earlier flunked a test for deputy chief. Rizzo was accused of trying to solicit political favors from a Democratic Party boss in exchange for construction contracts. He failed a lie detector test on that incident. Following his 1975 re-election, Rizzo began an even more tumultuous second term. He hiked taxes by 30%. He appointed more political cronies to expensive city hall jobs. He admitted to maintaining a list of 1,800 enemies, whom he allegedly spied on with a special police squad. All that led to an unsuccessful campaign to recall Rizzo. On the positive side, the Rizzo administration did succeed in making Philadelphia America's safest big city. It completed a massive urban renewal project and, for the first time, placed blacks in high-ranking city positions. In the fall of 1978, just before completing his eighth and final year in office, Frank Rizzo changed his mind about leaving, saying he didn't want to give up his city to the hoodlums. So Rizzo asked voters to change the city's charter, allowing him to seek an unprecedented third term in office. His bid was soundly rejected.
The mayor's political career did not just die of natural causes. It was executed.
But his supporters and critics have kept talking about the man and his record. Richard Chapman led the campaigns to recall Rizzo and to keep him from running again.
The city was mismanaged at that time, that there was this constant hint of corruption everywhere, that there was fiscal chaos, and more than anything else, a lot of bad feeling all around, not only within Philadelphia, but around the rest of the country about whether Philadelphia was a city to be taken seriously.
Philadelphia Daily News columnist Adrian Lee has been defending Rizzo for 25 years.
If I had to swear, and as a newspaper man, I would never swear that anybody is absolutely clean. But if I had to swear, you know, if I had to take an oath that someone was clean, I'd have to say Frank Rizzo is, if only because he's been investigated so many times. He's been worked over by experts.
Today, in this downtown Philadelphia hotel room, basking in the limelight only he could create, Frank Rizzo was back.
My strategy, I'm going to all the people, and I'm going to explain what I did for this city. And then let the record stand out there for everybody to see.
According to the latest polls, Rizzo is running 6 to 8 points behind his challenger in the May Democratic primary, a former managing director of the city. But Frank Rizzo has always marched into his political battles as the underdog and has usually wound up leading the parade.
I'm sure there'll be a big turnout both in all the city when I run. That's the advantage I have. I attract people.
Bob Serkin for Nightline in Philadelphia.
Joining us now live from our affiliate WPVI in Philadelphia is former Philadelphia Mayor Frank Rizzo. Mr. Mayor, the sideburns are a little grayer. What else has changed about you?
I lost about 30 pounds, Ted. A lot wiser. But what I really like to do is to comment on some of the things that were just shown.
Sure, go ahead.
First of all, I've never called myself the toughest cop in America. That was a media creation. Never did I say that. I just like to mention about my home, taxpayers' money. Well, I got about a 22-year mortgage left on that house. Anybody that wants to help me pay it, all that money that's in that house was my money that I worked for all my life. As far as the racist bit. That is absolutely untrue. All my life, all I ever did was protect people. And that's what a policeman is, a peacemaker. You know, while every other city in this country, Chicago, Detroit, Los Angeles, Washington, Newark, you name it, many people were killed and many injured and millions of dollars worth of property loss in the 60s, the turbulent 60s. And not Philadelphia. In fact, Philadelphia was so peaceful that many times I thought I was at the gates of heaven. And that wasn't just luck. That was a lot of people. And I happen to be the police commissioner.
I'll tell you what, let's keep on focusing on the piece just for a moment, then we'll take a break. What else didn't you like about it?
I didn't like the bit about the Black Panthers. The Black Panthers dropped their drawers. Frank Rizzo didn't order them to do it. I wasn't even there.
Why would they do that?
They were asked to open their trousers so that the police could look in the areas where they conceal weapons. And with that, in fact, I asked the press, I notified the whole media, to be there so that if anything went wrong, because I'm a professional and I know what could happen, I wanted the press there to be witnesses. So what they did when they were ordered to unbutton their trousers, they dropped them and turned their rears to the cameras.
Anything else?
Oh, there's a lot of things that were in the clip. Generally, you see, when we talk about the turmoil of the 60s, the clips that were shown, in some of them, there was, maybe a move situation. And they just show the action on the part of police. The clips that should have been shown also, Ted, the policeman who was killed, Jim Ramp, a fine policeman and a personal friend, his wife and family attending the funeral, about seven other policemen and firemen who were completely disabled, who are no longer policemen and firemen, whose careers were ended. The people in the community who continually came to my office as commissioner and as mayor to do something about crime. Philadelphia was the safest big city in the United States.
Yeah,
that's what it's all about.
The piece said that also. I'll tell you what, when we come back, we'll talk about politics today, Frank Rizzo today, and what you're going to do and what you're going to change, all right?
Thank you, Ted.
We'll continue our conversation in a moment. Continuing our conversation now with Frank Rizzo, former mayor of Philadelphia. By and large, Mayor Rizzo, the press has not been too crazy about you, and you've been able to contain your enthusiasm for the press. Why? Why has it been such a rough relationship over the years?
Well, I believe that I've made some mistakes, and I know that the press did. Reviewing and some of the statements that were made by Sirkin, Teddy, respectfully, half of them were absolutely, the question contained a lot of untruths.
Question is that?
Well, the things that he was explaining about Philadelphia being divisive, Philadelphia this, Philadelphia that, and then that fellow Chapman who was on, he represented the ADA, and the ADA, an organization that never supported me and some other people like me who had the same philosophy.
I mean, that's understating, isn't it? I mean, they hate your guts.
Beg your pardon?
I say they hate your guts.
Well, let me say this.
And you're not too crazy about them either.
No, that's not true. I just told them many, many times the Americans for Democratic Action, never, please don't support me. I discounted and didn't want their support.
You're a strange kind of Democrat. I mean, Democrat as a party, liberals who tend to be on the Democratic side of the aisle don't think too much of you. You once said that Richard Nixon was the best president who ever served.
Well,
explain what kind of a Democrat you are.
Oh, I'm a Democrat. Sometimes I support Republicans, and we'll talk about the president. While President Nixon was president of the United States, he did a lot for the people of this city while I was the mayor. And you know, a lot of people felt like me. It was one of the largest majorities ever in a presidential election. Now, President Nixon made mistakes, and he was punished for his mistakes and suffered greatly. I respected Nixon in a lot of other areas. He not only helped Philadelphia and its people, his foreign policy was good. I respected him because he was a supporter of Israel, like I am. And I can go on and on and on. So now Mr. President Nixon has paid his debt to society, and I'm not going to kick him while he's down. I think that President Nixon, one day history will show that he tried awfully hard to serve his country.
All right, let's bring everything up to date. 1983, what do you think of President Reagan?
I think President Reagan's a good guy. I think that President Reagan's a charming guy. I know him. I met him while I was the mayor of Philadelphia. I don't agree with his policies. I think that I'm sad. This country's in trouble with the millions of people unemployed. I don't know how people live today. The very old, the very young, the slash in social programs. I agree some of that had to be done, but not the way it's been done with an axe. There are people who are genuinely poor, people that need help. And Americans, one of our traits is to help people who need help. I would tell you that when I was the mayor of Philadelphia, they wouldn't cut heat off in a person's home because they couldn't pay the bill.
Well, I was about to ask you that, because if you became mayor again, you're not going to have the kind of federal funding that you had 4 years ago, 5 years ago, 8 years ago. They've slashed those federal funds. Why in heaven's name, you're 62 years old, right? Why do you want to go through all that nonsense again?
Well, first of all, I've been asked by many people to run. I love Philadelphia, and I know I can make it work. During the 70s, in spite of double-digit inflation, in spite of energy shortages, we moved this city. Philadelphia, we reversed it. The job loss was federal jobs that left because of the Vietnam War winding down.
That's the 140,000-odd jobs that you lost during your term in office?
And most of them were federal jobs. Federal installations that were closed down and most that moved to the Sun Belt states. Now, in spite of that, we turned it around. All the construction you see going on in Philadelphia today, the ribbons they're still cutting, are the result of the Rizzo administration. The ribbons that they're cutting, the people that are working in this city, and there are many of them out of work. When these jobs dry up, we got a problem. We turned it around. People were moving back to Philadelphia. People were opening up businesses in Philadelphia. Take the Saratoga, all the work at the Philadelphia Navy Yard. That was the result of my administration's effort. And when that Saratoga came down the river, all the people on it that were taking credit, I thought it was going to sink. I never thought it was going to get to Philadelphia.
All right, Mr. Rizzo, we'll come back in just a moment and we'll continue our conversation then. Once again with the former mayor of Philadelphia, Frank Rizzo. Mr. Rizzo, once upon a time you stood for something, you symbolized something. People looked at you, they said, that's law and order, that's tough, that's a guy who'll take no nonsense. Tell me why people shouldn't look at you now and say, that was then. He's a has-been, it's all over.
I think that most people realize that you can't have justice without order. And the 60s were tough years. There were issues in the 60s.
No, I understand. That's the 60s. I'm talking about the 80s now. Why should the Frank Rizzo of the 60s be applicable to the Philadelphia of the 80s? Or for that matter, why would you stand for anything that might be copied in other cities?
Well, if you just check my record in providing jobs and leadership and keeping a safe city, these are the issues of the 80s, and I'm intelligent enough to address them. I know I can make it work, and I have a proven record of being able to do the things that are necessary to make this a better city for all the people.
One of the reasons we asked you to come on is somehow the suspicion that if Frank Rizzo is reelected, and I should repeat, the polls are against you right now, you're quite far behind, but if you were reelected, that it might mean something in the rest of the country. That other politicians would look at that and say, uh-oh, there's a message there. You believe that?
No, Ted, I really don't. I sincerely believe that there people today are sophisticated enough to know and compare records. I'm very anxious to debate my opponent, for instance, my opponents, to talk about the issues of the 80s and who did what. And I'm saddened by the plight of Philadelphia today. Nothing is happening in Philadelphia.
Why does Frank Rizzo want to debate? That didn't used to be Rizzo style. You used to duck debates.
That's not true, Ted. I want to debate my opponents every day, as often as they want to, because, and I want to debate and I want to talk about the issues, how we're going to do the things that we want to do that must be done in the 80s, and then let the people decide.
You said at the top of this program, Frank Rizzo's made some mistakes. I haven't heard you admit any yet. Which ones?
Well, first of all, the charter change was a mistake, and to straighten that out, I'm very proud of what I accomplished. The charter needs to be amended, but I'm not going to try it again. There's some things that must be done in that charter, but I'm proud of what I accomplished. So you'll know, I got 250,000 yes votes, pardon me, and the people who were interviewed, pardon me, as a result of the poll, if we're going to believe polls, said we will not vote to change the charter, but we will vote for Frank Rizzo.
You think you sometimes were a little bit too rough in your dealings and a little bit too rough in your language?
No, you make that quote about Attila the Hun. Let me explain that one. When we talked about violent crime, violent criminals, I said that I will deal with them and make a bad, bad, bad. Now, we have to take it in context. I was only throwing out a little humor, but I meant it in my heart that I've been there. I have seen the victims of violent crime. I know how the young, the old were beaten and killed and all the other things. So I wanted to make my point how strong I felt about violent crime. I think it was a good analogy.
What are the issues of the 80s? Not just Philadelphia, you're talking to the whole country now. What are the big political issues now?
The big political issues, Ted, are jobs, crime, housing, feed the poor, provide medical care for the poor, housing for the poor. Let's remove the deadbeats from some of our social programs, but I repeat, I'm saddened by what's happening today. No way should a country as great as ours have people who are in need of food, heat, and all the other things that are necessary to survive and to provide a decent way of life for people. So I just think that we have to change some of our priorities, Ted. I think that we have to review what we're doing with our military spending. I think we ought to look at some of the monies we're sending to foreign countries. Maybe we have to evaluate that. I think charity begins at home, and we should take care of the people who genuinely need help in this great country.
All right, Frank Rizzo, it was kind of you to come in and to join us. Thanks very much for being with us.
Thanks. Nice to be with you, Ted.
I'll be back in a moment.